It's really good to be back at the barrel as a reminder that we, the new wine, the fresh oil, it is always our, it is always ours. And no matter what conditions we're in, you know, we can approach him, his presence, his goodness. And I really liked what Linda was talking about, that really in a time of tremendous challenge, tremendous difficulty, almost like the possible in the midst of the impossible. I just love hearing that. I love seeing that. Isaac sowed in time of famine. Well, guess what? He reaped at the same time as well. And so there's just something glorious and wonderful. He gets all the glory for that. We can't take any credit because in the natural, all this stuff is impossible. And we're gonna be in that theme once again, visiting in John chapter 11. We touched on some of that last week. The week before, it was in Luke chapter 10, and we were looking at Jesus with Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, and we're going to stay in that story. And, you know, one reason why I love this story, well, there's a lot of reasons, but now specifically because it's so relatable and it's so relevant to this sort of season of challenge and difficulty and sort of pressure that's kind of off the Richter scale, in the sense that, boy, this is way beyond our pay grade, way beyond our experience. We're not sure what to do. And this story relates so well to that. And once again, I'd like to highlight this, that this is not a history book, okay? The Bible is not a history book. It has history in it, okay? But it really is his story, okay, and we are in it. We've got to remember that now. It's not a history book. We do not read it as a history book. It has history in it, but it's his story, and we are in it. I love Romans 15:4 that says, what was written in earlier times was written for our instruction. In other words, this was written with your life in mind. Just think about that. The Holy Spirit is inspiring writing, stories being told, being inscribed with our lives, our season, our challenges, our world in mind. It's amazing. Think about that. You're in the book. You're in the story. And I've said this so many times, but I want to repeat it again. And that is, once you begin to discover, to see by the Spirit that you're in his story, you will begin to experience Jesus in your current present story. So anyway, let me just say this before we continue. We are Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. Like I said, this isn't about Mary. This is not about Martha. And it's really not about Lazarus. We are Mary, we are Martha, and Lazarus in this story, especially in John chapter 11, really represents the impossible, represents a challenge that just is beyond anything we have experience, we have knowledge for. You know, he was 4 days dead. Do you know what 4 days dead is? That means you're dead, dead. When you're, see, three, they would go and people got buried alive back in those days. And so they would go back and check a body for 3 days. And if the body was dead after 3 days, if it was still dead, it's dead, dead. you know the term dead ringer? Well, they used to put strings in coffins. And it was attached to a bell. And so if somebody came out of a coma or somehow they were still alive, they could ring that bell. So Lazarus is dead, dead. This is kind of one of those situations that's sort of way beyond. And that really is descript of what we're dealing with, what we're facing, whether it's the whole medical dynamic, the financial issue, the relational challenges. There's just so many battles that are going on in this season. And just a quick recap. The last thing that I highlighted from this story was and we're in John 11. And it was the two verses, John 11, 1 and 2. And I highlighted the fact that there of the detail that we have in two verses. We have so much detail. And what's interesting, you don't see that language hardly anywhere else. When there are miracles, when people are getting delivered, when blind eyes are being opened, we don't have all that specific detail. This is purposeful. It really is. It literally in two verses, who he is, where he is, who he's with, and what he's battling. All four of those things, his identity, his proximity, his community, and his adversity. Isn't that amazing? In other words, Jesus does not just know you generally. He knows you specifically, and he knows you intimately. And I'll tell you, just that truth, just that revelation will rock your world and change your life. Okay, now here's where I want to go. And this is basically verses John 11, 19 through 33. Lazarus has died. He was very sick. Word was being sent to Jesus to come to heal him before he dies. He dies. He's already passed away. And let me just a thought. Sometimes it gets worse before it gets better. You know, you're dealing with a challenge. You're dealing with a problem and an issue. Sometimes it's going to get worse before it gets better, but you need to see it in God's economy. You need to see it in the God story or the God context. Because it may be getting worse, but it's a setup for greater miracles. It's a setup for greater glory. If it's getting worse, I guarantee it's a setup for him showing up more. You need to know that. It's always the case. If it's getting worse, you know, okay, God, we're getting more. There's always more when it's getting worse. Anyway, okay, so let me just read this to you. Is that all right? John 11, verse 19, and many of the Jews had come to Mary and Martha to console them concerning their brother. Martha, therefore, when she heard that Jesus was coming, went to meet him, but Mary still sat in the house. Martha, therefore, said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Even now that I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give to you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection and on the last day. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall live even if he dies. Everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? She said, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God. Notice she said, well, I don't have time to dig into this, but notice she didn't say she believed what he said. Did you notice that? I mean, Martha's got a little bit of attitude. She actually didn't say, yes, I believe that. She says, I believe that you're the Christ, the Son of the living God. She couldn't go where he was going, but we'll say more about that in just a minute. Anyway, she said, then in verse 28, when she had said this, she went away and called Mary, her sister, saying secretly, the teacher is here and is calling for you. When Mary heard it, she arose quickly and was coming to him. Now, Jesus had not yet come into the village, but he was still in the place where Mary had met him. The Jews then who were at her house and consoling her, when they saw Mary rose up quickly and went out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep. Therefore, when Mary came where Jesus was, she saw him and fell at his feet, saying to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus, therefore, saw her weeping and the Jews with her, he was deeply moved in spirit. Okay, Here's what I want to unpack. Mary and Martha were at home, and they were being visited by mourners. Now, there's some interesting stuff in there, but I don't have time to unpack that. But Martha hears that Jesus is coming, and she goes to meet him. She gets up, she leaves, and she goes to meet him. And then after a brief exchange, and we heard the chat, the conversation, she goes to get Mary. Now, why does she do that? She goes to get Mary. Why? Well, because what she says in verse 28, she says to Mary, the teacher is calling for you. In other words, Jesus makes a special request for Mary to come. Isn't it interesting that Jesus didn't go to the house? He went to their house many times. He didn't go to their house. Now, I don't have time to unpack this, but there was a lot of pretentiousness going on. There were professional mourners in the day of Jesus. They were in the business of boo-hooing. They really were. People literally had the job of mourning. That's why, remember when Jesus came to the little girl's house and said, she's not dead, she's asleep, and they started mocking him? They were professional mourners. They were pretentious. Yes, there were real family and friends that were mourning with Mary and Martha, but there were the boo-hooers that were there. And see, Jesus is always there for us, but he's not always in everything. In other words, there's some things he's not coming into. So he was not going to go to the house. He wasn't going to go to the place of pretending, the place of falsehood, the place of pretentiousness. Now, that's a whole nother message. Sorry. I'm getting a little bit distracted with some other really cool stuff. So, but anyway, So he makes a special request for Mary to come. Why? I submit to you that he needed Mary to be with him in order for him to do what he was about to do. Now, Jesus needed Mary to be with him in order for him to do what he had planned to do. Okay. Now, before continuing, we need to see two other things. Every time we see Mary with Jesus, do you know what her position is? Do you know where she's positioned? Every time. Look at four times. Four times we find Mary with Jesus. Guess where she is? She's at his feet. Always. Four times she's with Jesus, she's at his feet. First time she was at his feet receiving, once receiving, twice ministering to him by putting what? Perfumed oils on his feet, right? All right? And then this time she comes to intercede. First it was receiving from him, twice ministering to him, and one interceding and partnering with him. That's actually what this is. This is an intercession moment, a partnering moment with Jesus that we have Mary doing. Now, there's a lot of cool stuff that we could say about feet. I mean, listen, I know my dad was a foot doctor. He was a podiatrist. I know about feet. but anyway, I could tell you some stories about my foot, but we don't have time for that. Okay. So there really is a lot of amazing stuff in Scripture about feet. I mean, wherever the sole of your foot treads, I've given to your hand. That's Joshua 1:3. People just think if I just show up and walk around, you know, the enemy's just going to flee and everything's going to fall into place. That's not what that Scripture means. The sole is the arch of the foot. It's the same place we get the word arch angel. It speaks of strength. When we show up with strength, these things happen, you know, these things we take possession of. We show up with the strength of humility. We show up the strength of kindness. We show up with the strength of faith. We show up with the strength of passion. Then these things happen. It's not just walking around, you know, but it's showing up with specific strength. Anyway, there's Jesus washing feet. I mean, we could go to a lot of different directions, but just for the, really for the purpose of this moment, his feet is where Jesus meets our ground. Our position, our situation, our exact place. The feet is where Jesus meets our place, our space. When Mary is at his feet, think about this. When Mary is at his feet, all she sees is Jesus in her spot. That's all she sees. That's it. She has eyes for nothing else. It's true. In fact, two people got mad at her because that's all she saw. That's all that mattered. Remember, too, not just Martha. Martha got mad at her because Martha was wanting to get her to help her make lunch. All she could see was Jesus's feet in her place. Judas got mad at her. Remember, he got mad that she wasn't using, taking that perfumed ointment and selling it to give to the poor. All she had was eyes for Jesus's feet, his feet in her space, his feet in her spot, his feet in her world. This represents heaven touching earth as our only option, our only hope, and our only priority. Now, I'm talking about in this context, the context of what do you do with this? I mean, we've not faced it before. You've never had this challenge. We are, and listen, it happens to us at different times in life. I mean, hopefully not every day or every week or maybe even every month, but every now and again, we run into something that is beyond us, right? And I would say right now, we are in a season. The globe, the planet, the nations, the governments. I mean, we are in a season that is really uncharted territory. We've never been here before. You know what I'm saying? It's like this is one of those, we need a heaven-touching earth moment. It's our only option. It's kind of like, in some ways, it's kind of good in bad, but yet good in the sense that our only option, our only hope, and our only priority. And that's what it was with Mary. Mary at the feet of Jesus, her only priority, her only hope, her only option was Jesus in that spot. And that I'm going to meet him where I am. I'm going to meet those feet. I'm going to meet him with him in this place. You know, Isaiah 52:7 often gets misquoted. You know how it gets misquoted? They say it like this: how lovely are the feet of him who brings goodness. Have you seen his feet? Lovely. It says, on the mountains, when it's in the rough terrain, the high altitude, low oxygen, steep, dangerous, difficult. Mountains aren't just glorious. Mountains are dangerous, challenging, sometimes scary, rough, difficult. How beautiful on the mountains. How beautiful are those feet in contact, in connection, in place, right where we are in something that is just so difficult, so rough, and so challenging. And the second thing that we need to realize, once again, I want to just reiterate this. There's a Mary and there's a Martha in all of us. We really are. And this isn't an anti-Martha message because you need Martha. Someone's got to make lunch, man. You know, sometimes you got to cook dinner. You know, you got to clean stuff. So this isn't like an anti, well, we don't need any servants, you know. I'm just called to pray, not shop. The angels, the crows, the pigeons will bring it to me. No, it's not that. Okay, but there is a time when your Mary has to come forward. Mary's got to show up from the church. And so we've got to see how special Mary is. There is such a beautiful anointing and quality about her, and it stands out in the scripture. In John 11:31, it says, when they saw Mary rise up and leave, they followed her, but they didn't follow Martha. Did you notice that? When Martha got up and left, they didn't pay any attention. Mary gets up and go, and they all want to follow her. You know, there's an attraction, there's a pull that comes. you know, from that merry heart. And then we have in John 11, 45, it says, many of the Jews who had come to Mary, it didn't say they came to Martha. It says those who came, and it was after the resurrection. They didn't come to Lazarus. They didn't come to Martha. It says those who had come to Mary and beheld what he had done, believed in him. Isn't that amazing? They came to Mary. There's a following. There's a coming. There's a beholding. There's a believing that only gets released with that Mary heart, that Mary focus, that Mary passion. And we all have that. Now, once again, and people sometimes struggle with this. God doesn't need anybody. I mean, he loves everybody, but he doesn't need anybody. That's not true. He chose to need us. Jesus needs us for certain things to happen. I mean, some things will never come out of his life unless we make certain choices. We exercise faith, our focus, our passion. Remember the woman with the issue of blood? Man, she pulled out of Jesus without he even being consciously aware of it. The centurion's servant, remember? He says, man, I've never seen such great faith. The centurion just said, you just speak the word, man. You know, the rest will take care of itself. How about when you got born again? You repented. You put your faith and trust in him. Jesus needed Mary because she could draw things out of him that Martha couldn't. Mary could draw things out of Jesus that Martha couldn't. Now, let me just say this. All that Jesus has for us is because he loves us. That's a fact. All he has for us is because he loves us. But what we receive from him is because of how we love him. We've got to know that. We've got to just get that down. All he has for us is because he loves us. He has it. It's already here. Has it for us. But we receive it according to how we love him, how we respond. It's all available. It's not, he doesn't do it for us. He doesn't present it to us because of our performance or our faith or our passion or anything like that. He presents it to us because of his goodness, because of his love, because of his heart for us. But the reception side of it, the activation side of it requires faith, requires our response. Can you say amen to that? In verses 21 and 32, verses 21 and verse 32, both Mary and Martha said the exact same thing. The exact same thing. If they said this, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I want to tell you something. When Mary said it, she got a very different response. When Mary said it, suddenly we have verse 33. When Jesus saw her weeping, and he wasn't just seeing crocodile tears. He was seeing her heart. He was seeing her passion. He was seeing her heart towards him. It says that he was deeply moved in spirit. Isn't that amazing? We don't see that response to Martha. You see, I really believe, and this, like I said, this isn't a criticism of Martha, but I think Martha had attitude. When you really look, there is a tone in her communication. Martha came sort of with the gift lens. You know, Jesus, you know, you're the healer. You got the gift, man. When you pray for people, they get healed. Whatever you ask of God, he gives to you. If you'd have been here and doing your job, he wouldn't have died. That wasn't Mary. That was Martha's lens. That was her lens, the gift. Looking, you know, you got the gift. Mary's was the giver. I know you love my brother. And I tell you what, that love never fails. Her focus wasn't the gift. Come on, do your job. Show up, God. Meet my need. That's the gift lens. And don't get me wrong, we need gifts. We need to operate in gifts, but it's the giver lens that raises the dead. It's the giver lens that draws stuff out of Jesus, draws stuff out of the heavenly realm that brings resurrection and brings life. Come on. Okay. There's some Marthas out there getting real irritated with me. Listen, I'm a Martha. I love Martha, man. Just next week I'll talk about how amazing Martha is. But right now, we need some resurrection, baby. We don't just need, bologna sandwiches. We don't need peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, baby. We need some resurrection. Mary is a resurrection heart. Resurrection intercession, resurrection faith. Amen. Oh, gosh. Question, how are we coming to Jesus? Are we coming to Jesus? Hey, you got the power. You got the gifts. Do what you do. Are we coming like that? Are we coming like we know how much you love us? And thank you for your love. And we keep our eyes on your never-failing love. We're not coming here because of what you do, even though we need that. We're coming here to be with you because of who you are. Who you are is, that's what we need. We don't just need what you do. We literally need who you are to show up. Yeah, 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 that'll preach. Jesus showed up with resurrection power, but Mary showed up with resurrection passion and focus. When it's Jesus plus a dozen other things that we are busy with, that's our Martha. That's Martha coming out. But when it's Jesus plus nothing, it's our Mary. And then finally, I've got to close with this. I want to share this. I know we're out of time. The shortest verse in the Bible. I wish I had an hour to talk about the anatomy of a tear. Some people call it emotional perspiration. No. It's heaven's irrigation system. But we'll have to save that for another time. But verse 35. It's the shortest verse in the Bible with the broadest range of impact. Shortest verse with the broadest range of impact. Jesus wept. Jesus wept. Why did Jesus weep? Why did he? We have him weeping twice, two recorded times in Scripture. He wept more, we know that, because of other scriptures and the epistles, but we only have two recorded times of him weeping. He wept over Jerusalem because they did not recognize the time of the visitation. That was a little bit of a different weeping. This weeping he wept because this is the exact same reason why we weep. This is the reason why. excuse me. Okay, where did I go? Oh, here we go. Let me get back here. Same two reasons, tragedy and triumph, grief and glory, sorrow, celebration, pain, gain, sadness, gladness. We do. We weep on one side because of grief, because of loss, because of hurt, because of pain, there's no doubt. But we also cry because we win. I mean, because of something beautiful and amazing and glorious. It's true. We do. They're like on both ends of the spectrum. Weeping are two extreme emotional responses, and they're on both ends of the spectrum. Extreme joy causes tears, right? Extreme celebration, extreme victory, right? And extreme loss. And extreme tragedy. And in this situation, there was both. Both were there. And like I said, there are different directions we can go with this, but they're at the same time. He was weeping because of the loss, the grief, the pain, the sadness that was real. But you want to know why he was weeping as well? Because, man, there's about to be something really awesome. I mean, we got some resurrection coming. Man, I got a big surprise for you. This is going to be so awesome. When there's a rescue, when against all odds, whenever you watch something, you know, a documentary, and there's a rescue against all odds, and someone that should be dead, they're alive, someone that should never have been found, and they are, you cry. You're just, whoa, right? It's like he had that. It was in the same place, the same space. You see, there is tragedy, there is grief, and there is pain. But at the same time, in the same space, there is triumph, there is glory, and there is gain. But you know, you gotta, how you find it? You find it at the feet of Jesus. You don't find it by being a Martha. You don't. You find that in that tragedy, in that pain, in that sorrow, when you're at the feet of Jesus. You know, that crying, when you're at the feet of Jesus, is where you find that. You discover that. You encounter that. You experience that. You know, we need to cry with Jesus. We need to be at the feet of Jesus. We need to grieve with Jesus. We need to be, listen, some people have a very different philosophy. Why are you crying? Why are you hurting? Why are you grieving? I mean, well, because there's trauma, there's loss, there's hurt. But here's the difference. We don't grieve like those that don't have no hope. Why? Because we grieve with Jesus. We don't grieve with the grief. See, you got to. There's the difference. We grieve with Jesus. You see, only Jesus can turn our mourning into dancing. No, it says he turns mourning into dancing. It happens. And it's so powerful. There's no greater testimony. That resurrection, I mean, there was death, there was loss, there was, I mean, everything was shut down, hopelessness, and yet the greatest miracle, the greatest breakthrough. And that's the season we're in. We need those breakthroughs, that resurrection, that life. You know, the job is lost. The business is gone. All the indicators just sink. It's not coming back. It can't happen. It's hopeless. It's a perfect setup for resurrection. But where are we camping? Are we at the feet of Jesus or the feet of our grief? At the feet of Jesus or the feet of our pain? Are we at the feet of Jesus or the feet of the tragedy? See, I remember when Adam first got diagnosed with cancer and I was camping at the feet of the grief. Guess what happened? It paralyzed me. And then I got up and I camped out around the feet of Jesus and it anchored me. Makes a difference. It really does. See, we have grief, we have pain, we have challenge, we have difficulty. But Jesus is right there. His feet are right there. Are we grabbing hold of him in the midst of it? Is that what we're focusing in on? We inviting him, or he's already there. We don't even have to invite him. He's inviting us to be at his feet, to be with him in the midst of it. Is that what we're doing? A lot of people are damaged because they're camping out around their pain. They camp out around their judgment. They camp around the anger. They camp out around injustice. You can't. Some people might not like this. You got to find Jesus' feet in the injustice. Find Jesus' feet in the hurt. Find Jesus' feet in the crime. Find Jesus' feet. Why? Because Jesus is the solution. His grace, his mercy, his goodness. That's where healing comes from. That's where our lives get anchored, in a place that's redemptive rather than destructive. If we camp around the pain, it becomes destructive. If we camp around him at his feet, it becomes constructive. And so I encourage you, man, and we all are invited to come to the feet of Jesus. Whatever situation for you, and we're closing now, whatever that is, whether it's a loss of job, loss of income, a health issue, marriage, relationship, whatever it might be, you know, Jesus is right there. That ground that you're on, that hard, dirty, difficult, rough, challenging ground, guess what? His legs, his feet are right there. And if you'll make that your focus, you'll make that your priority, I want to tell you something. You're going to find the triumph and the glory, the anchoring, the fruit, the breakthrough like you've never seen before. He's calling forth our Mary. Our Mary is showing up. Now, Martha, we need you. Okay, you got to do stuff. But I tell you what, we need something a whole lot more. And that's for you and that's for me. Anyway, I know I've gone a little bit over. I'm not going to apologize for it because it's so exciting being back here in this venue. And it's a good word. And trust me, there's a whole lot more in there. If you do not know Jesus, if you're not right with God for whatever reason, doesn't matter. Maybe you've never been born again. Maybe you're like the prodigal son and you run from the Father's house. Guess what? His goodness is right there. The feet of Jesus. Jesus is right there in that dirt, right there in that mess, right there in that fallen state of your life. And he's just, all you have to do is say, yes, Jesus, repent, put your faith and trust in him. I'm going to pray right now this prayer. And if you want to give your heart to Jesus, you want to really discover Jesus in the midst of that challenge and that darkness and get born again and that light shine and your life change, just repeat this prayer after me. Say, Heavenly Father, I thank you for Jesus. That's right. Heavenly Father, I thank you for Jesus. You sent Jesus to die for my sin. And Jesus was raised from the dead to make full payment for me. And I thank you this day, I recognize that payment for my life. I confess my sin. I repent from my sin. I turn and I put my faith and trust in your mercy and in your grace. Breathe your breath of life on the inside of me. Sit on the throne of my heart and be Lord of my life from this day forward. In Jesus' name, amen. We love you. God bless you. You're like super duper amazing. Turn around to somebody and tell them you're super duper amazing. We'll be back here. Right here. Actually, be praying for us because we are believing in August to start opening this up. We got all the protocols in place so we can start having gatherings. So we're shooting for August. So be praying for us, getting everything ready for that. Anyway, God bless you. We love you.